Keith is a longtime software developer who started his software development career writing in an in-house accounting package for a construction company on an Apple II in AppleSoft Basic. He's worked in several languages since and has been working mostly with Ruby for the last few years. He's lived in 4 continents and now spends most of his time split between Chiang Mai, Thailand, and Reston, Virginia. His handle on Twitter, GitHub, and LinkedIn is at Keith R. Bennett.
Hello, everyone. It's nice to be here. Hold on just a second. I'm going to start something here. I'm so happy to be here in the Philippines. I've been here many times before. But the last time was a couple of years ago, and it feels like a really long time. So I miss the warm smiles and the playful humor, the halo halo, and the karaoke. There comes a time when you find you need a tool, when a GUI's more trouble than it's worth. The command line is waiting there for you. All it takes is a little Ruby love. Moving the mouse, and then clicking, and then typing, all of that to do just one little thing. Automation, we do it for the world, so why don't we do it for ourselves? A CLA, command line application, will solve your problem. No need to stumble or fumble with a mouse. And then you will come to find a whole new piece of mind as you use your newfound productivity. Thank you. A couple of years ago, I resigned from my full-time job in the US to do some traveling and self-study and that kind of thing. And in the course of that, I was very reliant on the Wi-Fi of others. Hotels, airports, coffee shops, etc. And over the couple of years, I accumulated a lot of saved networks on my machine, over 400. And here's a random sample of some of them from a few different countries. But sometimes the Wi-Fi did not work. And other times, it seemed like over the last year or so, whenever I would click the Wi-Fi icon at the top of my Mac screen, I get the beach ball, and it would last it for a long time. It's as if it were growing to mock me. So I had to find another way to deal with my Wi-Fi, and I decided to go to the command line, where I was pretty comfortable anyway. And so this is one of the scripts that I wrote to do this stuff. It cycles the Wi-Fi off and on, just to kind of reset things. And I started sharing these with other people, and one person got back to me and said, you know, this may work for you, but it doesn't work for me, because you're assuming that the Wi-Fi port is always EN0, but on my Mac, it's EN1 because EN0 is my Ethernet port because I have an Ethernet port and you don't. So this and other things led me to decide to write a command line application to encapsulate all this logic and all the obscure commands that I needed to issue. It started out, I called it Mac Wi-Fi, but then I wanted to make it available for other operating systems, so I changed the name to Wi-Fi Wand. You heard me mention command line application, and that was intentional. I believe the command line interface exaggerates the simplicity of command line programs. Certainly, they are usually more simple than web applications or mobile applications, but on the other hand, they're usually a lot more than just simply an interface. For example, Git If you think about Git, Git is a command line application that, we use heavily. And to call it a command line interface would not do it justice at all. There were several decisions that I had to make when I started writing this. One of them was, do I want to use subcommands like Git does, or do I want to use switches like grep does? And I started out just using subcommands, but then I found that I needed switches. This is the help text. And I'm going to get the pointer here. Where is it? There it is. OK. There we go. OK. So the command line switches are at the top here, and the commands are down here. So I wound up doing both switches and commands. You'll also need to decide between perfection and expediency. Where's your optimal balance point? I realized that I didn't want to spend my entire life writing this thing, so I needed to decide where and when to compromise. And there are several dimensions to this. There's reliability and accuracy. There's performance, and since, for me at least, I was doing this human time, performance is not that important. There's OS support, and I would have liked to support many OSs, but I started out with only one. And there's automatability. It would be nice to be able to script this thing to do several things at once. But I didn't do that, but there's another way, which we'll see, that that can be accomplished. Another question I had to ask myself was, do I want to use the Mac utilities to access the Wi-Fi functionality of the system? Or rather, did I want to go deeply into the OS myself using system calls or AppleScript or something like that? I decided to use the Mac OS command line utilities because I felt that that simplified the application. I didn't have to do all that low-level stuff. What I found over time was that using the utilities complicated the implementation as well, because I realized that I was going to have to parse the human readable output of the other commands, but I didn't realize how many oddities there were and how fuzzy that could be. Here's an example of some code that parses the output of a macOS command line utility. It's the code that lists the network ports in your system. So here, the name is detect Wi-Fi port. We're getting an array of lines output by this command, and then turning it into, we're getting the output as a single string and then turning it into an array of lines. And this is a sample output. There will be several more, but this is a sample output. And so what we have to do is we have to find this line that has Wi-Fi in it and then get this. So the way we do that is we find the number of the line that contains this string, this regular expression, and then we make sure that we found it, and if we didn't find it, we raise an error. And if we did find it, then we take the next line, split it by this token, and take the last token that it found, which will be EN0. So that's kind of the kind of thing that you have to do. There were several requirements that I imposed on myself. I realized that most Mac users, even command line Mac users, are not Rubyists. And this application could be useful to them as well. So I wanted to minimize their barrier to using it. And also wanted to make it easily installable. And it's a gem, so it is easily installable. I wanted it to provide a shell. As I started using it more, I realized that it was cumbersome to have to issue a new command for every little piece of information I wanted or every little action to execute. And so I decided to create a shell. We have Pry, it was pretty easy. I was very concerned about non-Rubyists being concerned about installing software that they didn't know about. In fact, in the very beginning, this was a single file which they could just copy to their system and run, but now it's not, it's a gem. And so I wanted to minimize the number of gems that they had to install. Actually, I wanted it to be zero, and it is zero under certain circumstances. But here are the caveats to that. Pry is only required if and when the shell mode is requested. Awesome print is used when it's found, but it's optional. And if it's not found, then you fall back to pretty print. And for option parsing, I used optparse because it did not require the installation of another gem. It comes with the Ruby operating system, Ruby distribution, although it does need to be required, but it's not a gem. This is something which has been frustrating for me sometimes throughout my career. When I'm trying to deal with code, I'm forced to add some wrapper to get to the meat of the code. I wanted my users and myself to be able to use the underlying logic without having to run the command line application. And so if you create a command line application, you can also expose the internals of it so that people can use it however they like. And finally, and this is another pet peeve of mine, is that I wanted it to support output formats, JSON and YAML, because there are a lot of utilities that only output human readable text, and to pull those into a program to ingest them and use them requires a lot of extra parsing and work, and it's silly. Why would we want to impose that on others or ourselves? And in Ruby, it's so trivially simple to do, too, so the cost of doing it is extremely low. Here's an example of a task that I did using this Wi-Fi utility. I live in Thailand most of the time, and my mobile phone provider is AIS, and they have Wi-Fi in many places throughout the country, and so I use it frequently. But the login process is often problematic. And so sometimes I want to just remove all of the saved AIS networks from my system and start fresh. So this is a line of code which will get all the preferred networks and then grep for AIS and then put the resulting array in the variable AIS nets. So we get three matches. And note that the first one has leading spaces, which is an interesting complication that I can tell you about later if we have time. But we got three matches. And then we call the remove preferred networks method with those matches. And I have to input my password. And then it returns the names of the networks that it removed. This will not necessarily be the names of the networks that you provided, because if you provided any that were not there, it will not do anything to them and will not include them in the array that's returned. And just to make sure they weren't, that they were really removed, we do this again and see that they're not there. There's also a much shorter way to do this. I support also the short versions of methods. There's a minimum size and a maximum size, and you can use anything in between the two when you run, when you use the program, thanks to the method missing functionality. I recommend providing a verbose mode or at least some kind of logging mechanism so that the user can troubleshoot. And also in this kind of case where I'm using underlying commands, it can serve educational purposes as well, and show them if they want to use the commands directly, it'll show them how they can do that. And here's an example of what I mentioned before about bypassing the command line interface. And in this case, I really do mean command line interface, because it's literally the command line interface class of this command line application. And so I have a little script and call it public IP, and this is all it does. It creates an instance of the macOS model and then calls, I'm pointing at my screen, you can't see it, I'm sorry. It creates an instance of the macOS model and calls the Wi-Fi info method on it and then gets the value whose key is public IP, which is itself a hash, this hash here. So it shows you the address, city, region, country, location, organization, and this is helpful to me as a traveler, because as someone who's not in my primary country, there are websites that I need to go to in my country that I cannot get to if on the internet I appear to be outside of the country. And so I use a VPN that provides about 30 different countries, and I'm often setting it to the USA. For example, PayPal I cannot log into if I'm not using a US address. The last doctor's office that I used had a website, and you could not log in there unless you're in the US. So that can be helpful. Another thing that can be interesting about using other countries is that you can look at how your web pages look in in different locales. And in fact, I've had trouble sometimes using different countries and going to contacts.google.com and seeing the labels in the other language. I talked about supporting JSON and YAML format, and I do, and a few others as well. This is the command line option, the minus O, and I support inspect mode, JSON, pretty JSON, puts, and YAML formats. And this is what they look like. This is without any option at all. It's just the default human readable format. And this is the inspect mode, JSON, pretty JSON, puts, and YAML. And I felt really good when I did that because it was so easy to do, and I'll show you how that works. This is the code that parses the command line option, the minus O command line option. All of the logic is in this hash. The keys are the characters that you would choose as the option, and the values are lambdas. And all of the lambdas have a uniform interface. They all take an object as a parameter and return a string. That makes it possible to just plug them in somewhere and use them without having to know which one it is. Another advantage of this is that down here where we do the validation, we can use the array of keys to our advantage. We can ask, does that array of keys include the choice that was made? And if it doesn't, we can create a very helpful error message. And we all know, I hope, that the very helpful error message will show you what you did wrong and give you some kind of clue as to how to fix it. And so here we show the list of valid choices. Note that using this approach, you can change this logic without having to make any other code changes. So it's very powerful, it's very robust, that kind of approach. Obviously, you want to use all the available tools to simplify the implementation. You don't want to reinvent the wheel. We've talked about Pry and AwesomePrint and JSON and YAML support. There's also Open. Open is a command line command in Mac OS that lets you open a resource, and you, for example, a file or a directory or an HTML page. Open will find the default application for dealing with that type of resource and call it with the resource as an argument so that it will open correctly. There were a couple of things that I wanted to offer in my program that I couldn't do directly in Ruby and couldn't do well and couldn't do inexpensively. But what I decided on as a compromise is just give the user a shortcut to open the web page that would give them the information in a nicer way that they were accustomed to anyway. So for example, speedtest.net or a couple of websites for giving you information about your IP address. And I even included my project page so that people could go there and post issues without having to do too much fumbling. And by the way, Windows has a similar command called start. I don't know about Linux. This is the basic class design. There are some trivial classes in addition to this. But on the left, we see the main class, which is the entry point to the program. And it instantiates and uses the command line interface class, which instantiates and uses the macOS model, which is a subclass of base model. I separated these out in preparation to add other operating systems support. Several people have criticized this design and say that inheritance is not a good way to accomplish that. And I'm looking into those other designs, but it's a little bit more complicated than it looks at first. When I first implemented the shell, I just duplicated the functionality of the non-interactive mode and just output in a nicely formatted way what the information was. But quickly I realized that that wasn't so useful because I want to be able to do things with the objects that are returned, such as the grep that we saw. So here's an example of listing the preferred networks on the command line non-interactively, and then below interactively. And interactively, you can see that what you're getting back is a Ruby array. It's nice to have the option of a long expressive name for documentation, for example, in these slides. But it's also nice to have the option to specify the commands very briefly. If I'm issuing the commands often, and I do, like I'm constantly doing a cycle and getting the network name and showing the Wi-Fi info and stuff like that, I have the shell open in the leftmost tab of my window, my terminal window, so I always know exactly where to go. And I don't want to have to type a long name every time I want something. So you have support for the short name, the long name, and anything in between. And that's because we have method missing that can help us with that. If you do this, you may find that there are convenience methods that would be helpful, which aren't really directly related to the subject matter of your application, in this case, Wi-Fi. For example, when I remove the functionality, when I change the functionality from outputting a nicely formatted string expressing the value of an object to merely returning the object, I lost the ability to easily do the former thing. So I added a method to the command line interface class, which has nothing to do with Wi-Fi, but it just calls the formatter to format the object. And I created, if you're using Awesome Print, you can use AP, or if you're using Pretty Print, you can use PP. But I put this in so that you wouldn't need to use it, especially for non-Rubyists who wouldn't know about Awesome Print and Pretty Print. And there's a long name, Fancy Puts, and I also aliased it to a short name, FP. And you can see that's how we can use it. Of course, Pry is a full-featured REPL, which is really nice. And a big advantage of Pry over IRB is that you can run external commands by preceding them with a period. And also, there are Pry commands, such as ls, that you can access. And I've configured the percent character to be the prefix that's used for that. When you call other command line applications, and this applies whether or not your application is a command line application, there are a few things that can be helpful. One of them is, unless you're handling standard error and standard out separately, redirect standard error to standard out so that you get it back if something comes there. And inside, this is the notation that's used for that on the shell. Use the exit codes to determine success or failure. And the dollar question mark will give you an object which contains the exit code. And by the way, a common misconception is that all variables beginning with dollar signs are global. That's not exactly true. Some of them are thread local, so they're not global in the sense that there's only one of them. They're globally accessible, but they're not global in the sense that there's only one of them for the whole runtime. You have one per thread, which makes it safe to use. It's nice to provide a way for the user to see the commands and their outputs so that they can learn from that if they choose to. And finally, when you have calls to the external shell, I recommend writing a method that handles that. Even if you don't think you'll need it, you probably will. I found nowadays I just start writing the method. I call it run OS command. And then if I want to change something about the way all of those commands are issued, I can change it in one place. And this is the one that I use. It takes the command and whether or not to raise on error. And this is the back ticks here. And we're doing the redirection here. And we're executing it. And the joined output goes into the output variable as a string. If we're in verbose mode, we'll output the command and its output. If the exit status is not zero and we have not suppressed error handling, then we raise an error, and this is a custom class that has some useful pieces of information. And then finally, we return the output string, which is what we would have had with the backticks by itself. Shell words. Certain characters are interpreted in certain ways by the shell, such as spaces, or argument separators, dollar signs, or variable prefixes. So if I were to issue this command, can you see that? Is that too small? Raise your hand if you can see it. Okay, thank you. Okay. So this will give us only A because the space is a delimiter of arguments. But if we escape the spaces, then we'll be okay. And if we enclose the string in quotes, double quotes will be okay. Single quotes works also. But we can ask Ruby to do this all for us, so we don't have to do it ourselves. There's a shell words module. It's not an external gem. You just require it. It's in the runtime. And you can call shell words escape and it'll do all that stuff for you, and it'll handle backslashes and dollar signs. So I recommend looking into that. Here's just an example of output of the command with the non-verbose mode versus the verbose mode. Non-verbose at the top above the blue line, verbose below. You can see we have printed out the command, and this long file spec is one of the reasons I wanted to write a command line application. And there's lots of stuff like this that makes it helpful to encapsulate all of this stuff in a single program. You'll need to provide an executable with your gem, and when you call bundle gem to create a skeleton for a gem, it will provide this line here, which is kind of cryptic, but it works. But I could have also just done that, and it would have worked too, because that's the only one that was found. And it can be, and probably should be, a very simple wrapper around your other code. So for example, this is what's in my executable. It's just creating an instance of main and calling it. And everything else is in the other code. So this executable can be really, really lean. It's a good idea to include the version and the project URL in your help text so that if they report a problem, they'll give you the version number so that they know where to go to report the problem and they can find out more about your program. Ruby is a great language for domain-specific languages. The optional parentheses means that you can write methods and they can appear to the user as commands of the language, like almost like keywords. So it's a lot more English and it flows better. And because you don't, and it's also more concise, you don't need the parentheses. Also because of method missing, I don't know if any, does any other language have anything like method missing? I don't know of any.
Crystal.
What's that?
Crystal.
I didn't hear that.
Crystal.
Oh, okay. Well, Crystal's great too. but anyway, the method missing is pretty amazing when you think about it. It enables this handling that no other developers, other than Crystal developers, can enjoy. And it's very powerful for this. And in addition to those features, it's interpreted, not compiled, like any scripting language. It has a rich tool set. And in addition to the MRI implementation of Ruby, we can also use the Java implementation of Ruby, which is JRuby. One reason to do that might be if you're in a Java shop and you want the command line application to make use of software written with JVM languages. Could be Java, it could also be Kotlin or Scala or Clojure. And another reason is that there may be cases where you're not permitted to install an executable, but you can copy a jar file and use it. And so if you can't do the former, you can enjoy using Ruby by using JRuby, and it's really handy. So that's what I have for you, and we have some time for questions, if anybody has any. I guess not. Okay.
I have a question.
Yes.
So you wrote this Wi-Fi tool to help you like do all of that stuff without having to click around so much.
Yeah.
Have you noticed other things you wish someone would have written, like another command line application that fulfills or solves some repetitive task?
I'd have to think about that. I'm not sure. But I'd be interested in what other people would have to say about that. I can say that I really appreciate it when I do see a command line application, like Heroku, for example.
Hi. So I've also tried writing a small command line interface for command line application, but the thing that I'm always having a hard time with is that how do I test the actual thing? Because I looked at your GitHub and it says that there's no... So my idea right now is that since it's a Ruby application, I just test the inside, then from the outside, just check if the string got passed inside. How do you, that's what I'm thinking, but maybe you have probably more experience on that. How do you?
I was hoping no one would ask me about testing.
Sorry.
You know, I tried, you know, this is a really unique environment. You're dealing with networks over which you have no control. And I wrote some tests just to do the high level testing, like is it successful in turning off the network, turning on the network? But you gotta realize when you run those tests, you're affecting the whole system. Yeah. Like if you ran that on a host, like a DigitalOcean host, for example, or something, you know, you could break down a whole system. So it's not as deterministic as the classical testing, and it was just really hard. So the testing is very minimal.
What I just do is just try the actual thing, like just the command, right? So that's okay.
Yeah, well, the one test suite that I have simulates that, and so I can do that. But it's crude. It really is.
Okay, one more. Okay,
hey, so obviously you're using also a lot of like some system calls or some built-in applications. I wanted to know if you find yourself often mixing the shell language, some bash or ZSH with Ruby, or if you have some way to split it, or you just avoid using any bash at all?
Well, the interaction with bash or Z shell, which is what I use, is limited to anything that passes through that run OS command that was there. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, so you're not using any other stuff in the bash? Like
no.
In your shell, you're using, for example, head or tail, but only when you're calling the command. So inside your application, you're actually not using any of this stuff.
No, I mean, the shell that this program provides is a Ruby shell. So if you were going to access it, you'd have to do what you do in Ruby, you know, use backticks or something if you wanted to do something in bash.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask if you find yourself doing that often, or if your Ruby applications are almost free of doing the shell.
So you're asking if I find myself often using this shell?
If you find yourself often using these backticks or calling the system calls from the Ruby applications.
No. So you mean in this shell, if I'm calling other operating system commands using backticks? No. Just in my use case, it's pretty simple. I'm not doing that much.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Last two questions.
So you shared the reasons why you think Ruby is a great tool for building a command line application. Did you ever consider other programming languages to build it? And if so, why did you?
I did not, because I'm most comfortable with Ruby. And from what I know, it has the features that make it really good for that. You know, the method missing and the optional parentheses. But I would be curious to know if you have other candidates that you think would be as good or better. I'd really like to know. I might not use them because it would take a while to learn them, but I have been assuming that Ruby is the best language, but if I'm wrong, I'd like to know that.
Yeah, I am not an expert on this regard, but I have heard that, for example, in Heroku, they did use, at some point they changed it to Go, and I think someone told me that they also change it again. I'm not sure, but
well,
Node, yeah. So they're saying that they changed it to Node. So I watched the talk about why they changed it to Go, and the reason was because of they wanted to run in multiple, you know, operating systems, and they think that the distribution basically it makes it easier for everyone to install it. So
that's true.
But that's a very high level view. I'm not.
No, that's very legitimate. I mean, if I were writing this like for, you know, really like for a company or for the world that was really concerned about that stuff, that might be the best choice. I was writing it, you know, for free on my own time, and I decided to use Ruby for that. I was most comfortable with it. But sure, that's good too.
Thanks.
Thank you, Keith.
Thank you.